regarding monitoring, this sugar fasting,
Mike,
BP,
Mike.
Hello. ठीक है सुनाई दे रहे बोलो 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 रिगार्डिंग मॉनिटरिंग ऑफ दिस ब्लड शुगर फास्टिंग बीपी HbA1c यूरिन बिसाइड दिस नाउअडेज ग्लाइसेमिक वेरिएबिलिटी टेस्ट इज बीइंग रिकमेंडेड इन सेंटर फॉर एक्सपेरिमेंटल एंड विजुअली व्हाट यू आर थिंकिंग दिस इंपॉर्टेंस ऑफ दिस टेस्ट इन द कमिंग फ्यूचर डे और is it only in the experimental phase or is it going to be helpful for us to decide on the both prognostic point of view and for regarding
I think that's a very well thought out question in this present context I think test for glycemic variability and the most common in this index used for that is made mean amplitude of glucose expression. There are few more others which I do not remember and have difficult formula, but the calculation of formula is not a problem. You can download an app and you can do it. But I think these are excellent tools for the at present for the experimental field. If you devise a study through CGMS, you do it. But I think for clinical practice, at present with patients, especially on oral agents. If you try to test for glycemic variability, you will lead yourself and the patient into confusion. So I think still we are new to this concept of glycemic variability. It is good to hypothesize, it's good to theorize, and it's good to work upon. But I think still we have to fall back on the traditional parameters of fasting, postprandial, self-monitoring values, repeated as needed, repeated self-monitoring, and glycated hemoglobin, and maybe during pregnancy or something, serum fructosamine if that is available. You have to still go by that for any therapeutic decision in an average patient. Maybe in a type 1 patient having peaks and valleys, that can be an exception. But in an average patient, I think the traditional indices are fair enough. But yes, I do see a possibility maybe 5-10 years down the line when we would be looking at those indices in clinical practice. But today, I think outside of experimental protocol, I think these are not needed.
Regarding this IFG, that is the intermittent fasting glucose and intermittent glucose tolerance, lifestyle modification and medical nutritional therapy, whether we will add any oral hypoglycemic agent on the very beginning?
Right, that's also a very practical question. If you go by evidence, DPP, that is the Diabetes Prevention Program, has shown that any agent or any intervention that has the greatest impact on preventing IFG-IGT to diabetes is therapeutic lifestyle change. That is diet and exercise. Metformin comes next. The stop-nitin trial employed acarbose and that prevented. Then the DREAM and ADOPT, I think, used rosiglitazone. And we can also theoretically think of using a DPP-4 inhibitor. But I think what is must is a therapeutic lifestyle change. If you think metformin is going to help, you can add metformin and maybe an acarbose or for that matter, alpha glucosidase inhibitor. The point is that where are the situations where you would think of using metformin or an AGI, especially if the patient is obese, having an upper tail of IGT. Means IGT is 141 or 142, 199. If the patient's post-glucose load is say 145 or 150, you can think of not starting metformin. But if the patient's post-glucose load is near about 190, you can think. If you think that the patient cannot probably comply with lifestyle modification as you would have loved to, there's a case for starting pharmacotherapy. But I think still in the stage of pre-diabetes, of which we call now high risk for diabetes, therapeutic lifestyle change should be the most actively encouraged treatment. And of course, in some other additional patients, you can think of metformin, maybe an alpha glucosidase inhibitor.
Okay. In that particular setting, glucose will be the better choice because it will help in the pancreatic regeneration.
Theoretically, it would be a better choice because, well, you do not have the problems of hypoglycemia. Theoretically, the beta cell preservation, the point is that we yet do not have any outcome results to recommend it.
Yes.
So that's the problem. But off level, you can use it. I tell you, I have had one or two patients whom I had used a DPP-4 inhibitor in such a situation. One particular patient, I gave met because I found that this patient wouldn't really listen to lifestyle modification. I tried with metformin, couldn't tolerate. In that patient off level, I gave DPP-4 inhibitor, but I think that shouldn't be a routine practice as yet.
Just inquisitiveness as to, is there any change in the management of surgical patients in of type 2 diabetes? Or do we still stick to the traditional methods of the rapid acting insulins and is there any role for these newer drugs or agents in the management of surgical patients?
That's again a topic by itself. There are many changes. The first is the glycemic targets. That is, previously, you know, first following Vandenberg's first trial in the surgical ICU, people was going overboard to target a 110 ambient glucose. Now, following nice sugar and everything, we have, and again, Vandenberg's second study, we have now gone that we should target a ambient blood glucose between 140 and 180 milligram per deciliter in the critically ill patients and in the surgical patient. I don't know what is the status in your hospital, but in my hospital and definitely in the posh corporate hospitals that I occasionally go to see patients, the GIK, glucose, insulin, potassium, is grossly underused. So GIK is a very useful agent for controlling glycemia in the surgical patient. And regarding, I think, in the surgical patient, an acutely ill patient, a patient who is not feeding properly and are prone to hypoglycemia, insulin remains the safe bet, and insulin analogs, especially the short-acting insulin analogs like lisinopril or glucagon, are better compared to the conventional insulins, mainly for the cause of hypoglycemia. And those agents, DPP-4 inhibitors, and I think they are not contraindicated as such in the surgical patient, but then in such situations, I would prefer insulin over any oral agents for that matter, because you know, control of glycemia is much easier with insulin than with any group of oral agents. But yes, yeah, say maybe a small surgery, maybe a dermoid cyst or so, not employing anesthesia, not requiring fasting or a cataract extraction, may jolly well be done with the patient on oral agents, including this. But in the surgical patients, I think insulin is the best option.
Whether this SGLT or degludec is available in India?
SGLT2 is not yet available in India. Degludec, I think I'm told, would be launched sometime in July, August. So degludec has been launched in Europe. So it's
regarding iaglutazone and rizagliptazone. You told me rizagliptazone have already sent to there by clinical society since last 2-3 years. Not as very few clinicians are using rizagliptazone. In India, it is almost banned.
No, rizagliptazone is more effectively banned all over the world.
And regarding now, you told that it is going to come back.
Yeah, US FDA is re-examining the efficacy and safety. I read in the news, and their verdict would be out sometime in mid-June.
Yes.
But again, I don't know in it because many of them are class effects. How can you say that with confidence that I don't know whether the concern of bladder cancer is true or false with pioglitazone, but how can you say that this is not a class effect?
Study for this pioglitazone on how many years continuous you lead to bladder cancer. There are some central studies going on, and that's why the public not yet published. But we are now have a clear mind that whenever on long terms pioglitazone, because it is a wonderful drug, and it is a particularly add-on drugs which is working very excellent. But regarding this concern for bladder cancer in every forum, but it is not yet any. Fully published data yet not come. A few centers are studying it. I think otherwise we have to this group whole group will die now. That's the only.
I think that is 24 months of 45 milligram of pioglitazone is risky. So 45 milligram for 2 years. So if you use it's a cumulative dose. So 30 milligram maybe a little bit more. So. These are all retrospective analysis, not a prospective study. Now they are looking at it prospectively. Whatever data from California and maybe Europe came, these are mainly on the retrospective analysis. And they have said that 2,800 patient years of experience is bad, definitely bad. And 45 milligram, not more than 2 years, definitely you should use. So if you believe that, if you go by that.
There is one last question. What is about the smart insulin? What is that?
Well, smart, these are, you know, insulin delivery, this is basically in the delivery systems. Insulin is incorporated into certain cells, smart cells. These are actually not biological cells. These are nanopolymers where the glucose will, and it's added to certain enzymes. Now, as glucose diffuses into the cells, beyond a certain threshold, say glucose level of say 100 milligram percentage, when beyond that threshold, that insulin is dissociated from its chelate and will be released. If the glucose falls below that, insulin released from that smart cell will stop. So it is sort of trying to close the loop, some sort of glucose sensing, but again, it's in early stages of development, really very fascinating to read, but I don't know whether would be able to, making it foolproof is always a problem.
So there will be less chance of hypoglycemia.
Again, the same thing to be having less chance of hypoglycemia. The cells will sense the ambient glucose in the bathing interstitial fluid and insulin will be released accordingly.
Is gliptin is safe in pregnancy after organogenesis? Not yet.
No, gliptin has not been recommended. I think no teratogenicity has been recommended.
It is not safe. And regarding what's your prescription, how can I save myself the use of metformin after organogenesis in 3rd month onward? What the association is saying, it is absolutely safe or 2A or 2B?
Metformin is category B approved.
To be approval.
Not category.
So we can jolly well
but,
type
but
this.
But metformin is not teratogenic.
Yes.
Metformin
that's
is,
why it is
not teratogenic. There is not yet any recommendation to use metformin in by any August body, any recommendation to use metformin in pregnancy. But I tell you, metformin is safe. Many a time I
particularly
do use
for
it.
Those issues women with pregnancy. Well,
that's
the ideal way
continue. But yeah. I think in pregnancy, controlling blood sugar is most easy with insulin.
Yes.
And this is one situation where you do not have patient resistance. You can convince the patient to take insulin for her baby. Patient here, she would take.
So any questions? Thank you.
Thank you.